Malole Soifua I tātou tangata I le Pasifika. Well, it's been a world-changing week, and we'll talk in a moment to Pacific Island people near the nuclear danger zone of Fukushima and the exploding nuclear reactors, and further south in Tokyo itself. We also have updates with Tangalotele Osone Okasinge in the quake-ravaged city of Christchurch. But first to Japan, where massive explosions in the Fukushima nuclear plant have leaked radiation. On the line from Koshigaya is English language teacher Kerry Harding. Kerry, you are just 180 kilometres south of Fukushima. Are many people leaving Koshigaya?
In my particular area, I have seen some people with suitcases leaving the particular area, but down south into the western part of Japan, or leaving to go overseas. Yes, some people are leaving.
And it's unbelievable that I hear you're still working, Kerry.
Yes, the show must go on, as some people say, but people are getting back to work. Taxis are still going, public transport's still going, so people want normality back, and part of Japanese spirit is they keep trying to get on with their lives despite what's happening.
I'm glad to hear you're safe. And how have people reacted to a triple disaster?
That's a really good question. Here in my particular area, just north of Tokyo, or what we call the Greater Tokyo area, a lot of people are panic buying, which is caused by a lot of the CNN, BBC, Reuters type media into the world, international media. So here in the southern part of, the middle part of Japan, Tokyo area, the people are buying and hoarding things, really, and it's making things worse for those living up in the north area where they have absolutely nothing.
Of course. And so what are your plans now? At what point will you decide to leave?
It's a really good question. Here in my particular area, you'd think nothing had happened because the buildings are still standing. The infrastructure here is a lot better than that in Christchurch. So despite the fact that it was 9,000 times worse than the Christchurch earthquake, buildings are still standing. Mm. And I'm not quite sure when I will leave. A lot of the information regarding the nuclear plant is, we all sort of understand that, and apparently they have things underway
under
there,
control.
But I'm not quite sure when I will leave.
Okay, well, stay safe, and thank you so much, Kerry, and all the best over there.
Thank you very much.
And still with Japan, Rona Lee Hadfield is also an English teacher. She works and lives in Tokyo. Although she's 250 kilometres south of the troubled nuclear reactors and in one of the world's most populated and technologically advanced cities, it's tough. Madame Papau spoke to Rona via Skype this morning.
Thanks for joining us. First of all, Rona, how are you coping at the moment?
Just, staying positive and just trying to keep calm and not add to the chaos and this madness that's happening around us in Tokyo.
What have you heard about how other Pacific Island people are coping over there?
Some of my Kiwi friends, Kiwi Samoa friends, have left the country. There were some Samoan students that were stuck up in Itanaki, that's a lot closer to where the epicenter is, but they have since been evacuated and they're now with the Samoan embassy staff. But yeah, so everyone seems to be able to cope and remain calm.
We're hearing a lot over here about the damage to the nuclear power plants. How real is the fear where you are?
Well, the fear is definitely real, but I think it's because a lot of people are selectively either reading the news or listening to the news. All they're hearing is like nuclear explosion, but Tokyo's about 250 kilometres from the nuclear plant, and which is about the same distance between Auckland and Taupo. I've heard people say that, you know, you get more radiation from a CT scan. Some people have reacted. I think a lot of people with families, small children, have left the country or have left Tokyo or have moved further south down in Japan. But for us, trying to keep a level head and make sure that we inform our families back home that we're not in any acute danger, and just making sure that they know that how far we are from the nuclear plant.
Has this changed your thoughts about staying in Japan or your family begging you to come back home?
Yeah, I'm that's the other disruption to my life as well, is just not only am I not able to have proper sleep because of all the aftershocks, but, you know, just the constant phone calls and messages from our families, you know, worrying because they're seeing the footage. But honestly, if anything, this whole experience has just reminded me why I never left Japan when I was supposed to leave after a year living here. This experience has just made me appreciate, you know, being able to be a part of a culture that I can learn a lot from.
Thanks, Rona, for that update. To Christchurch now, it's been nearly a month since the earthquake shattered the lives of so many. In Christchurch, we have Tangalotele o Sone Okesene. Tangalotele, how are our Pacific communities doing now?
Thank you, Angela. The healing process has begun. It's going to be a very slow and long road to recovery, but I think it was boosted a little bit today with Prince William coming in. I'm joined now by Amanaki Misa to talk a little bit more about our Pacific communities. Amanaki, how are Pacific communities faring?
I think that a lot of them, they know about the services available provided by the government departments. Just after last week, as we spoke on Thursday, on Friday we had mobile services who went out to the Cook Islands. On Saturday we had one mobile service who went to the Samoans and the western side. And on Sunday as well, we had a mobile service who went out to the Samoans and the eastern side. So a lot of them know about the services available and are accessing the assistance provided by government and NGOs.
Now, I understand you've got a new thing happening, the Pacific Hub. Tell us, what is the Pacific Hub?
Well, Osana, the Pacific Hub is basically a working space that we have located, we have established in the eastern side, and it is staffed by staff from the Ministry, Housing New Zealand, Department of Labour, and non-government organisations such as Pacific Trust Canterbury, Pacific Business Trust will be there next week. But it's basically a place where our Pacific community and the eastern side can access. They can either ring, there is a landline number, it's 964-9064, or ring the ministry's number. And if they've got any issues whatsoever or would like to access the assistance from government, this is in addition to the mobile services out there, as well as the recovery assistance centres. Basically a place for Pacific to go or to ring, and then we will connect them with government agencies.
Thank you, Amanaki. Back to you, Angela.
Thanks, Tangalotele and Amanaki. Just to repeat that information, the Pacific Hub one-stop shop for all help for quake-affected Pacific Islanders is at Heartlands, Aranui, phone 03-964-9064. And some sad news for the St. Paul's Trinity Pacific Presbyterian Church congregation. The historic church will be demolished. Reverend Lapana Falitolu says a new St. Paul's will rise in its place. Now back to Tangalotele in Christchurch, where we understand the CBD is opening up.
Yes, Angela, that's correct. The CBD is slowly opening up, but very limited access still at this stage. Some of the businesses are allowed in, and they are able to go and secure their properties and their goods. But I'm joined by the manager of Iconic Bar, one of the managers, Sam Siave. Sam, how is it as far as like getting access to that CBD?
Well, it's very difficult. The council and the civil defence are doing the best they can to allow as many people through as they can. But there's a lot of buildings to cover, and some of us just haven't had a chance yet to go and inspect the premises.
Now, on that fateful day, you were there at the bar, and you were holding the hand of a dear friend of yours, Jamie Gilbert, who didn't survive. How has that affected your life?
It's one of those moments in history that it will never leave me. It's tragic to be in the presence of someone whose life is ebbing away, let alone under such devastating circumstances, and so sudden. It's not something I prepared myself for at the start of the day, and it's something that I go through constantly. A number of times during the day I'll stop and think about those moments.
You've been touted as a hero. How do you feel about that?
I'm not sure I like that word, hero. I was someone who was there at the time who was able to help, and there were others there as well. There were other people that stepped up to help, And probably more deserving of that title than I, because I was probably the only person that knew Jamie and Amy were in the rubble. These were total strangers passing by that stopped and helped in the efforts to rescue them.
Thank you for joining us, Sam, and we hope that your life will gain some sense of normality as we go through this healing process.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Angela. Back to you.
Thank you, Sam, and Tangalotele there in Christchurch. Stay with us. After the break, we catch up with the tour man before this week's Weekend Backyard Brawl.
Record on paper, you know, it doesn't look flash, but for me, you know, I never have and I never will take nothing for granted. I'm well prepared for this fight, and I know it's coming to fight, so I'm looking forward to it.